protection, oh God. Oh Lord, we praise you now and throughout eternity. Oh God, our Lord Jesus. Oh God, Almighty God. Oh Lord God, forever we praise you. Oh Lord, we worship before you now. Your fire that it falls around us. Oh, your glory that dwells here now. Oh, your hand that molds and shapes us, oh God, according to the fashion of your will. According to the fashion of your will.
Hallelujah.
Oh, Jesus. My sanctuary, Lord Jesus Christ, my Savior, you're my dwelling place. Lord Jesus Christ, my Savior, Lord, my sanctuary. Lord Jesus Christ, my Savior, Lord, my dwelling place. Your hand that shapes and molds me after the fashion of your will. Your fire and glory rest upon me, surrounding us with your mighty power. Lord, we worship you.
Hallelujah.
Oh, we love you, Father. We love you, Jesus. We thank you for your love for us. Oh, God, we worship you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Oh, my God, my King. Oh, my Lord and Savior, Jesus, Lord Jesus, Jesus, my God. Oh, Jesus, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, we honor you. Now we will bow down and worship. I'll obey you no matter the cost. My Redeemer, my Savior, oh God, my King. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we praise you. Lord, we yield ourselves to your perfect will.
Have your way in me. Have your way in me. Have your way, oh God, in my life. Have your way in me. Have your way in me. Have your way, your perfect way in me. Oh, your glory now, God, your fire, your presence, Lord, like rivers. Oh God, your glory now, your fire, your presence, Lord, like abundant rain. Oh God, your glory now, oh God, your fire, Lord, your presence like the wind. Oh God, you're clothed in tongues of fire. Oh God, revival once again. Oh God, a people now who know you. Oh God, reveal yourself in me. Whatever the cost, oh God, I willingly pay it. Whatever the sacrifice, it's easy to do. Your presence is better than all the riches. Oh God, be glorified in me. Lord, your glory now, oh God, your fire. Lord, your presence like the rushing wind. Oh God, your glory now. Oh God, your fire. Lord, your presence like abundance of rain. Oh God, your glory now. Oh God, your fire. Your presence like rivers flowing. Oh God, your glory now. Oh God, your fire. Your presence like a rushing mighty wind. Oh God, your glory now. Oh God, your fire. Oh Lord, your presence like abundance of rain. Oh God, your glory now. Your fire. Your presence like a mighty stream. Your will, your way, your will, your perfect way. Oh, your will, your way, your will, hallelujah, your perfect way. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days, and let them flow in ceaseless praise. Oh, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my will and make it Thine, or it shall be no longer mine. Oh, take my heart, it is Thine own. Oh, it shall be Your royal throne. Woo! It shall be Your royal throne. Hallelujah. Take my will and make it Thine. It shall be no longer mine. Oh, it shall be no. Father is just looking for some people who will respond to His amazing love and mercy and be willing to be consecrates. To be consecrated to His will and to His purpose, it's not hard at all. It's the glory divine of fellowship. Too many people have come and they've seen the Lord, but the fellowship with Him, the interaction with His presence, never became bigger to them than the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye and the pleasure of this world and demonic interaction and natural things and human desires. But oh, what would happen when God's people begin to say, "Oh Lord, I'm gonna be Your dwelling place, and I'm gonna give myself every day unto Your praises, Lord. Oh God, I'm gonna be Your holy place, and I give myself to You in all Your ways. Come be welcomed here, O God. Come be comforted. Find that place that You have dwelt forever. Find that place in me. Take my will and make it. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. Hallelujah. Tonight, we want every one of you to grab a hold of God and be comforted in the Holy Ghost. We want every one of you to grab a hold of God and be strengthened by the power of His might, be encouraged, knowing that you're well able. Somebody begins to talk to me about the impossible, or the enemy comes along and tries to assail me or to distract me or to discourage or condemn me. And I just say, I'm well able. I am well able. Hallelujah. For it is God who is my sufficiency. And I'm well able to do these things. Tonight we're going to talk to you about how God will take you from where you're at right now into the greatness that He planned for you, that He purchased for you. The Lord purchased for us greatness, authority, power, dominion. He purchased for us not only power and authority over all the spiritual realm, but He purchased for us the ability to move in Him and to have a dominion and authority over everything that belongs in the earth. There was a day not too long ago that there was not a king in all of the civilized world that was allowed to step into a place or a position of rulership unless some man of God anointed that person. That's long since been lost, and it was so corrupted. It was so good in its beginning, but it was corrupted and it was lost. But you know what? The authority and the power is available for anybody to step into. You have to step out of the things that have distracted you. You have to step out of the realm of human living and that which has been acceptable to men, and go ahead and become partners with Almighty God. And let Him form you and shape you and make you and develop you and prepare you. Oh, what God will do with a yielded vessel. Oh, what His hand will do. If you and I would be willing to be molded and shaped, fashioned according to His will. And so I'm talking to you tonight about moving in great faith. Hallelujah. Moving in divine ability. Moving in a place of confidence that it doesn't matter what it looks like, how long it takes. Doesn't matter. You're confident. I am absolutely confident about the great things that God will do. I don't care about all of the naysayers and the gainsayers and the waysiders. There's been many waysiders. There's been many who began, who fainted. There's been many who laid their hand on the plow and they've looked back. It makes no difference. Changes nothing. For in it God gleaned those who would not faint, who would not weary, who would not be waysiders, who would not look back. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Their Father has fashioned for Himself a prepared people unto every good work. He purified us from all iniquity. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. May the treasured people zealous of good works. Zealous for the glory and the power and the might and the authority and the splendor of the Almighty God to be revealed in the midst, in our midst, in our midst, where we fall down before Him and worship Him. Glory revealed in our midst, where we get to behold Him and look upon Him beyond all that we've known or understood up to this point. There are many who weary in well-doing and they faint, because they've never learned how to wait, how to minister unto the Lord, how to delight themselves in their God, how to receive comfort from the Holy Ghost, how to receive strength in the day and the time of opposition. Oh, how to receive the ministry of the Spirit when all things are set against you. Yet you find that you're not alone. For the Father, Christ Jesus, the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. <Woo-hoo>. Has entered into a divine partnership. Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer. Take my heart, it is thine own, and it shall be your royal throne. Oh, it shall be your own. What a blessed thing privilege is. It is. You can be seated. You know, it doesn't mean that you're not going to have assailing thoughts. Does it mean that you're not going to have opposition? I'm going to tell you right now, you begin to become a threat to the kingdom of darkness, and Satan will mount everything he possibly can mount up against you. And that's why you're going through what you're going through now, so you learn how to stand. Two hands for beginners. You learn how to crawl before you walk. You learn how to walk before you run. Hallelujah. 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 You know, it's awesome when you're not blind, but you can see off into the future. You can look and behold the inheritance that God has for you. You know, I love to think about the things that God has for me that I'm going to be doing with Him 10,000 years from now. It's a great perspective for me. My hunger, my passion, my thirst will ultimately be fulfilled when I behold Him face to face and I see Him as He is, because I'm going to be like Him. That's cool. But you know, there's also an ability to look now and also recognize, wait a minute, I'm being challenged with the things I'm going through. I'm dealing with the opposition and sometimes the suffering. And it's not suffering and agonizing over some broken bone or pain in your body. It's much, much deeper than all of that. And you're able to look beyond all of those things and you see, Father, you know, with all the disappointments, all the discouragements, with all the seeming postponements, you're able to see, wait a minute, the Father's doing something great. He's never going to weary. He's never going to faint. He's going to watch over it. He's going to perform it. He's going to hasten. Hallelujah. He's always investigating our life to see what we, to come to understand what He presented before us, what He desires for us to see. You know, I often think, and I was thinking today of Jeremiah versus Hananiah. Hananiah came and there is religious zeal of what he believed and his indoctrination as a priest and the son of a priest in the priesthood of Israel. And he spoke out of that zeal and it was false. Jeremiah came anointed of God and prepared of the Lord. And he spoke out of divine revelation. Oh, Mamantekela. And Father has helped me understand of times where I've spoken out of my zeal, of those things that I know and I'm persuaded out of, about, that we've received as tradition, as concepts, as understanding about what God wants within the framework of our own denominations and relationships and heritage, if you would. But then there comes a place, you know, where all of a sudden there's a distinction between that in the revelation of the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Divine revelation. that comes many times after you've been almost like in such a struggle, in such a battle with one assailing thought after another assailing thought, with one discouragement after another discouragement, where it's almost like in many respects Jesus was tempted of the devil 40 days in the wilderness. Not just three temptations, 40 days, a barrage of intensity. It didn't match what he went through in the Garden of Gethsemane, where the same forces of hell try to kill him and destroy him there. Or he's with an agony, an intense opposition, standing against all of the assailing thoughts and all of the things that would try to sway him. He sweat, as it were, drops of blood. I've not tasted that. But I know what it's like to stand there with one thing after the next, after the next, after the next, after the next, and find myself hid away in confidence in God, saying, I come not with sword nor shield. I come not by my own strength or power, but in the mighty name of the living God. I stand here. I will not be moved. I'm well able. Yes. I pray that you let God prepare you for such a fight and for such a conflict.
Yes.
Because you discover there, the angels always come minister to you. Hallelujah. Yeah, discover there that you always step into a place where now you have been developed and prepared to be able to move in a greater authority. I will not let the state of California and if Oregon and Washington remain the same. You can stand by and watch me if you want. I will not. I'm pressing in. I have a heavenly vision. I am right now in training. I am developing skills where Satan cannot touch me. Where everything that he says falls before me is nothing. Father's inviting you to come too. Too many people listen to the lies of the enemy and they sit there and meditate on it as though it's their own ideas, as though it was some revelation from God. It's not written in the Word. God didn't say it. If it's not what Father has written in His Word, the Holy Spirit is administering it. You're going to have to learn how to stand up, take your place in God, and refuse to be swayed by anything. God's looking for some people. I refuse to be limited. I refuse to move out ahead of God. But I refuse also to sit by, occupied with normal, occupied with, you know, what seems to be good. And Father has given us a divine power and authority and mandate that there's nothing that can stop us. First thing you got to deal with is if you got laziness in your life, you're going to have to deal with it. Because this is wide open, everyday hard work. That's what I want to show you tonight. I want to show you some things that the Lord has revealed to me. I want to be able to impart them to you. I want you to be able to understand this confidence and this boldness and this assurance so that you can begin to move. I mean, I'm telling you right now, I got a flag in the Holy Ghost planted in northern Washington at the coast, right on the coast where you can look and see Canada on the other side of the sound. And I already set up camp down here on the border where you can go and look. You can stand on a couple of hills nearby here and see Tijuana. If you know what you're looking for, one day I said, there's a lot of Tijuana. There's nothing that can't be. You figure it out. It is. I already figured out a long time ago. I know it's closer than what you realized. It's closer than what you realized. And you know, it's just like, okay, Father, I know how you begin. You always begin with one person. You always begin. You don't despise the day of small things. Some people they've got wrong ideas and wrong concepts about how God's going to do it. And if you find yourself trusting in Him, laying hold of something that you're so desperate about, and that is His glory manifested, His power revealed, and your heart's fixed on it, I mean, you're right in line with what Father wants to do. I can imagine the day in the not too distant future when the Holy Ghost power falls with explosive torrents of His power upon San Francisco and the Bay Area. Because that's about middle. Not, you know, quite, it's a little further north to be middle, but there's not much there. You know, it's the southern coast of Oregon, there's not much there. They'll get the overflow of it. So we're making a plan. I'm making a plan. Me and Pops, me and the Lord Jesus, me and the Holy Ghost, we're making a plan. Somebody says, what does it take? It takes a mouth and feet. You can do a lot with a mouth and feet. Feet carry you there. Mouth opens up and speaks. God then begins to move. Wow. Is that all it took? Just feet and a mouth? God provided you with two very good ones and one very good one. Hallelujah. 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 The prophets of old did not have to rent a venue, pay for a music group. They just stood and began to proclaim the word of God in the street corner. And suddenly things begin to happen. They break it open. They break it open. Why? Because there was an authority in their life, an anointing given, a divine ability that nothing could resist. God's going to do His work. He did His work in a radical way through Jeremiah. Jeremiah asked Papa to give him signs so that the people would believe him. And at first, God gave him no sign at all. He just had a mouth and 2 feet. And everybody just despised him and scorned him and mocked him and laughed at him. But suddenly, after the things that he started saying coming to pass, they still would mock him. And he was like a good guesser. The Lord wouldn't give him any miracles like He did Elijah. Same anointing. Just a diversity of gifting. Effectiveness was absolute. Same effectiveness. I want you tonight, I want you to begin to listen very carefully to things I'm going to say, because I'm going to tell you where you find your boldness. I'm going to tell you where you find your confidence. I'm so blessed by the people who already told me that they already listened to this morning's meeting before the night even got here, that were busy in the morning service. God will bless you for that. He will honor your diligence. There's got to be a consecration and a diligence over the things of God more than over your own personal things. Those are the first transitions you've got to go through. You may not like that. You may feel bad about that, but that's just the way it's going to be. So be glad.
Yes.
Just be glad. And don't act like God somehow has left you out and cheated you when you basically have not done what you're supposed to do. He didn't leave you out, and he didn't cheat you, and he didn't shortchange you. He's the God of mercy and faithfulness. He upholds everything he says. You and I have to conform. We have to agree with him. We have to walk with him. We have to say, look, I need a priority shift. I need a desire change. I need commitment change. I mean, I've seen so many people have great calls of God upon their lives, even anointings upon their life. You see me just prophesy over them. It didn't matter where they were at. He would prophesy over them because of the anointing call of God upon their life, but they never learned how to live consecrated to the Lord. So thus it made no difference. I was talking to a person in this state last night who did not believe that he was going to make it through the night. It's congestive heart failure, 40%. His heart was only working at 40%. A great anointing in his life abdicated. Never learned how to be consecrated life. Never learned how to walk in consecration. Never got thrilled about the fact that his heart had become God's royal throne. Had encounters, but the encounters never resulted in a divine desire bigger than a natural desire. In a passion for the things of heaven more than a passion for the things of the earth. I told him, I said, no, the Lord, you'll be alive in the morning. I called him out this morning and I said, how are you doing? He said, it was a rough night. And he said, we're just one thing after another, but I'm here. And I said, you'll be here. The Lord's going to give you yet another chance. But you're going to have to learn righteousness because you've learned perpetual backsliding. Your anointing has never been valued by you. You've valued money more than you've valued the anointing. You valued your own life more than the life that Christ Jesus has given you. It's so sad. I had an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ and I fell in love with him. I fell in love with his presence. I fell in love with his goodness. I fell in love with heaven. Money became dirt to me. Natural things, human abilities, things that you can gain in this life became ashes to me. I experienced redemption. In that place of experience redemption, I became that which is everything that was holy and acceptable to God. I never come to God based upon my own righteousness. I come to God based on his righteousness. See, he's given me perfect righteousness. And in that perfect righteousness, I get to learn righteousness. I come to God based upon his holiness. He gave me his holiness to get the holiness, his perfect holiness. I stand before him totally holy, even as he's holy. Not earned, gifted, that I may learn holiness. I never come to God based upon the merit of my failings or my successes. I didn't come to God boldly because I did this great thing or I did that great thing. I never come to God shame because I failed here or failed there. I come to God because of his righteousness. I am the righteousness of God. I'm just going to talk to you about where boldness comes from, where confidence comes from, where divine power and ability to defeat every foe comes from. So many people, they get discouraged. They want to give up. You know why? They've never known redemption. Really. They never came to the spirit of wisdom and revelation. I got the cure. I had the disease. But now I got the cure. I had the spiritual disease of sin and separation and being undone and alienated from God. And I got the cure. I got double cure. I can come in with all boldness into the holies of holies, not threatened, because I have His holiness. I don't have my own. I have His holiness. I'm holy like He is holy. I've been empowered by Him. I can come with all confidence and stand before Him as a holy and acceptable offering, because I have His righteousness. He gave it to me. I'm righteous even as He's righteous. Not by merit. Not by any works of righteousness which I've done. Because I've been gifted with His righteousness to stand one with Him, accepted in the Beloved, my existence being in Christ Jesus alone. Now I'm emboldened to receive empowerment to fellowship with Him, which then causes me to totally disdain all other things. But without that, you're in a struggle. Without that, you're in a struggle trying to do what's right. Trying to keep up, and boy, are you ever out of breath. I entered into the rest. I have ceased from my labors. Creation is done. I'm complete in Him who is the head. I have been made righteousness by the faith. I have been made justified or righteous by the faith of Jesus Christ. He bought me, He purchased me. The bread of heaven came and gave me His life to eat. I eat His life. His life is in me. These are the doctrines of Christ. With the doctrines of Christ, you could go on to perfection. Without them, you can't. With the doctrines of Christ, you never have a sense like, oh, I've got to give up. I'm just not going to make it. I'm just not worthy. That's you. That's your legalism. That's your earthly achievement of trying to be good enough. That is debunked, disqualified. You must be worn slap out. I'm accepted in the Beloved. With all my faults and failings, I house God Almighty. With everything that somebody else can see is wrong, Papa sees nothing. I have both salvation by position and by experience. It's both accounted to me and imparted to me. I have both relationship righteousness and ethical righteousness. It's true. So do you. You just don't, maybe you don't know it. Because you have this, I tell you right now, you're gonna rest. You're gonna be, woo, God is so good. God is so good to me. He leads me in the path of righteousness for His name's sake. Surely mercy and goodness follows me. The Lord is good, and His mercies endure forever. And though His law is established and His word is written, and there contained in the ark, above the ark is His mercy seat where He rejoices over judgment. The cherubim stare at Him, watching His every move in response to what goes on. Ready to take whatever down that needs to be taken out. Can you imagine face to face with the cherubim like Ezekiel? My. What God was able to show a man who is willing to walk with Him. What God will show you when you get out of your stuff. You get out of your stuff. I'm going to be passionate about Him. I'm going to be passionate about His house. I'm going to be passionate about what He paid for me to have at the Calvary's cross. I went and I laid my sin on Him.
I laid my sin on him. And the innocent became guilty that the guilty may become innocent.
The sacrifices of the Old Testament teaches us very clearly what God did for us at Calvary when Christ bore our sin in his own body. I laid my sin upon him, and the innocent became guilty, and I in exchange became innocent. And he's willing to do it. You should be willing to receive it. Should not let the faith of God and the grace of God be in a vain. Amen. Because I promise you, you begin to lay hold on this, you begin to accept this, you receive redemption. Ha! Where your sins and your iniquity is moved as far as the east is from the west, where he remembers them. No! Oh! Where many, because of his obedience, it abounds unto many offenses. You won't tire anymore and say, oh, well, it's just too much. I'm trying, but it just ain't working. No, you're not yet begun. You're not yet begun. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm just so thankful for all the people. Sometimes I forget. Please forgive me. So thankful for all the people that watch by web all over the United States. Got some great messages today, emails, text, about, you know, one person said, you left the altar call open for me. You know, what God just, I mean, it's wonderful, the web and the people who give themselves to it. And I pray that you give to yourself to it excellently, because I hate to think that people are basically got their, you know, TV turned all the way up with their ear and up to it and a bunch of static sound trying to hear the word. Wouldn't that be terrible because somebody didn't want to do what they needed to do? Huh? Come on, people. God's giving you an assignment. It's between you and him, not between you, him, and me. But I'm going to tell you right now, if I don't obey God, there's a lot of people that are not going to hear the word and they're not going to be able to see. They're never going to know. And so goes for you, unless you begin to obey God and his word. I was not interested in your sacrifices, my sacrifices. He's not interested in you having to say, how am I doing now? All the time, do you like me now? Now do you like me? Do you still like me? Am I still doing good? Because you're so full of fear and insecurity. I just look at Jesus. That's how I'm doing. The author and finisher of my faith. the one who began a good work in me, who's completing it, having begun by the Holy Ghost. See, the Spirit of the Lord ministers righteousness. It's the ministry of righteousness. Hallelujah. Here's joy unspeakable and full of glory. See, the redeemed of the Lord. If you understand the characteristics of redemption, you then begin to know whether you've got it or not. I have it. The redeemed of the Lord return and come with singing unto Zion. And everlasting joys on their head. And anything that tries to take that from me, I won't allow it. Sometimes it's a battle. Sometimes it's a fight. Sometimes it's a struggle. Sometimes, you know, there's no one around you to encourage you. The church is a wonderful thing, isn't it? Because of that wonderful comfort and help and partnership that we, huh? You pray more passionately with a couple more people around you. You do. You do. And this isn't a show-off thing. It's a divine hookup thing. Huh? It's not a performance. It's a divine hookup thing. I love the church. I love the church. I love it. I love the abiding place. I love the people who've come to learn mercy and faithfulness. But you're never really going to be able to minister it until you receive it. You've got to look at the place called the mercy seat. For God is there enthroned. That's his seat. That is his chair. His chair is the mercy chair. That's where he sits. That's where he sits. And he sits over top of all his judgments and his command. And he said, that those commands say that they that do these shall live and they that do not do these things shall die. And he sits enthroned and his mercy rejoices over his judgment. Judgment without mercy is justice. Wherein the person who's done wrong must pay in full for their sin. And every sin is worthy of death. But But God, who is great in his love and mercy, God, who is rich in his mercy, God, who is rich in loving kindness and compassion and mercy and full of goodness and faithfulness, has commended his love towards us. He'll be spared not his own son when we were dead in our trespasses and sin, but delivered him up for the sins of us all. What's it look like now? What's it look like now? Because I came to the Lamb and my guilt was transferred to him and his innocence was transferred to me. My death was transferred to him and his life transferred to me. God gave me the bread of heaven and I eat it and I have the life, his life. I've come in response to a divine invitation and I live in him and I dwell in him. I live in his house. I sit at his table. And I'm not a descendant of an abdicated kingdom and a rebellious father, grandfather, brethren, with broken legs. Mephibosheth. But I sit here whole, complete in him. And so do you. You just don't know it. I want you to know it. I want you to get the spirit of wisdom and revelation, the knowledge of him. I want you to understand what he did for you because of the good pleasure of his goodness. Hallelujah. Because of the good pleasure of, because of his own good pleasure. We who are dead in our trespasses and sin have been made alive. And you and I don't exist outside of Jesus. All your stuff is where you're existing outside of Jesus. Stop that. I don't come to him on my righteousness. I have his righteousness. If I fail or transgress your sin, I ask him for his mercy and forgiveness, and he keeps me in his righteousness and his holiness, so I can come in with all boldness by the blood of Jesus Christ to a place that is forbidden to all, that was forbidden to all, the holies of holies. This is where faith is activated. This is where you can begin to move in a great confidence when you speak that God will work and move and act upon your behalf. Because it's a fellowship, it's a relationship, it's righteousness that is truly based upon relationship. It's relational righteousness, which is truly foremost. You know, Paul constantly used Abraham at the center as like he was trying to argue with the Jews about, you know, their reliance upon Moses, and he went back even further. He said, let me tell you about where Moses heard it from. Let me talk to you about Abraham. And you see Abraham, hallelujah. In simple obedience to God, God gives him righteousness. God gives him empowerment, says, be perfect and walk before me and be perfect. Gives him divine ability. And he just accepts it and receives it. Says, hey, you know, he becomes a mighty prince of God just because he believed God. He agreed with God. And it was accounted unto him for righteousness because he believed God. God told him the most wild story. You know, it's one thing if you've got 6 to 10 children and God says your children are going to be like the stars of the sky and like the sand upon the seashore. You know, you're like, well, you've got a good start. You know, it's been very fruitful up to this point. But it's another thing. But you lived your whole life and you got nothing. You've not had any. You tried every day of your life since you've been married and there's nothing. And in the midst of nothing, God said, I'm giving you everything. You're childless, but you will have more children than anybody. You're looking around. Everybody's got more children than you. God said, you're going to have more children than everybody. And he believed, he agreed with God, and Father said, that's righteousness because you believe with me, the impossible. You believe the impossible. You believe that which you cannot imagine. You believe that which goes beyond all reason. You believe that which goes beyond human strength. Yes. Hear it. Because that's the basis of all this. That's why Paul constantly going back to Abraham. You know, it's all easy to imagine when you're so removed and distant from it and you look at the other side of it. But how about when you're living it? It's time to agree with God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I got verses of scripture running through my spirit right now, like Philippians chapter 3, verse 9. Romans chapter 10, verse 3. These radical testimonies. Galatians chapter 2, verse 17. These wonderful testimonies of God. Second Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 9. Whoa! We ought to read some of them in case you don't know what I'm talking about. The living word dwells in me. Hallelujah. This life of God is mine. The bread of heaven feeds me every day. I find myself continually taking another sip of communion. Any offense I take, I have another bite of the heavenly bread. Jesus said, Moses didn't give you the true bread. I am the bread of heaven. He that eats this bread lives forever. The life of God comes. He brought to us his life and gave to us the ability to live his life, to be existing only in him. I exist in him. You exist in him. You'll never stand before him on your righteousness. You have his righteousness. And all your interaction must be based on that. And when anything, any failure or any credit, when there's any success or any bad events or whatever tries to impose upon that, you set it all aside. Where is boasting? There's no place for it. I have it all. Paul gave himself desperately to achieving a place of acceptance with God, to by merit find that place of righteousness. And then one day he encountered the righteousness. And that's what he says here in Romans chapter 10. And it's a very important doctrine of Christ to grab a hold of in Romans chapter 10 and verse 3. It's just going to highlight some things for you. And I want you to give yourself to just meditating on the word. You know, I have people come to me all the time saying, you know, I'm failing here, I'm failing there, I'm weak here, I'm weak there. And one of the first things I do is I'll ask people, do you have a daily diet of the word? And most every time, probably 99.9% of the time, people will say to me, no. That is why. Because the word of God is something very spiritual. It's spirit in its life. It is a communion and it is a fellowship. And you want to have that. It will enlighten you. It will strengthen you. It's better than having honey when you're exhausted. Huh? Jonathan had a little bit of honey after fighting all day and it was like, whoa. Huh? His word is better than honey and honeycomb. You're all faint and weary, huh? And you're exhausted from battling all day. Have some honey. Have some honey. Have some honeycomb. Hallelujah. Have yourself a drink of this wonderful sweet stuff. This flavor of heaven. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Romans chapter 10, verse 3. And I'm just start off in verse 1 just so you can get it. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. It's Hananiah. It's not Jeremiah. It's a tradition. It's a family heritage. And out of that zeal, they are determined to proclaim what they believe out of that zeal and call it the Lord. But there is an anointed one speaking, and it's going to just destroy all of your ideas. It's going to bankrupt every human concept that you have. It is. What God's going to do is he's going to teach us how to think in terms of miracles, in terms of him doing it on our behalf. And he says to them, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness, have gone about to try to establish their own righteousness, having not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believes. And you understand, that now, according to Romans chapter 3, verse 21, the righteousness of God has been now been made manifest without the law. The righteousness of God has been revealed in Christ Jesus and been given to anyone who will accept. And the Lord brings it down into such clarity for you and me if we would just listen. If we'll just grab a hold of the faith, if we'll grab a hold of that which Father did for us when He worked the miracle of the new creation and come to realize and understand something so simple that He became the sin offering so that you and I might be made the righteousness of God in Him. And as we read about in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, one of the great chapters of the Bible, one of the great chapters of the Bible that just lies barren in within the framework of our knowledge. We've never given ourselves to be enriched by all that God said. And one simple chapter of the declaration of this miracle provision of redemption that has been given to us. You know, 2 Corinthians 5:21, saying it yet in another way, where we have now, behold the Lamb of God, a Lamb that all the offerings spoke of in all the times past, all the way back to Abel, where we now take this innocent Lamb and bring this innocent Lamb before God, and it is slaughtered on our behalf, and through this wonderful transference of life, the innocent becomes guilty that the guilty may become innocent. It takes my life that I might take its life. And now He became my sin offering that I may be made the righteousness of God. To literally have God's righteousness. Amen. You can't get better. You can't get better. You can never become more acceptable than Christ Jesus makes you the first moment you call upon His name in sincerity and truth. You can never be more acceptable. To somehow be more acceptable makes you now back under the law, makes you now make grace void. Somehow you're still over in the realm of human efforts, the arm of flesh, that which has completely been shown to be disqualified. I pray tonight that you will understand that God gave you His righteousness, and we stand before Him with His righteousness, and in His righteousness we learn righteousness, both relational righteousness and ethical righteousness. That you recognize that it has been imputed to you as well as imparted to you. It's been encountered unto you as well as you have been made it. I've been made it. I've been made the righteousness of God in Him. If I can just get you this, you'll never have Satan will never be able to get doubt across to you through condemnation. That's the primary way he transfers doubt and unbelief, is through condemnation and shame and defiled conscience. Oh, just take another sip of communion. Hallelujah. Just take another bite of the heavenly manna. The bread of life. Hallelujah. 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 Look with me quickly in Philippians chapter 3. And you know, look, I could spend the rest of the night, if those of you who know me, been around for a while, I could spend the rest of the evening just talking about Romans chapter 10, verse 3. There's so much to say there, and I encourage you, give yourself to it. There's so much revelation there. It's about you. It's about you. It's about who you are in Him and who He is in you. Suddenly there becomes an empowerment in this relationship. That not only do you have your one, not only do you are you acceptable in the Beloved, not only do you have an unbreachable, an uncompromisable position in God and oneness with Him, but suddenly you begin to get a heavenly vision. You know you can do it all. You know you can do it all. You begin to make plans. I'm making plans for Washington, Oregon, and California. You know, I'm not going to just sit around and babysit you. I'm going to love you. The church is going to go on. Hallelujah, here in San Diego. But I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to go on a lot of other places. You better start running if you want to be a part. Because if you're sitting around here, who knows, you might be on your own. You might be sitting home by yourself. Now, where did everybody go? They all went. Hallelujah. They all obeyed. They all obeyed. Go ye into all the world, preach the gospel. And there you are sitting going, wow, man, I just don't feel like this is right. Yeah, it's perfectly right. It's perfectly right. It's time for you to be so filled with relationship with Him that partnership begins. That relationship so filled with relationship with Him that partnership begins. Huh? So empowered by Him to do all that He has commissioned us to do all that He's doing, to stand in His behalf and to speak all the words of life that He's put within us, in our heart and in our mouth. To do all the works that He Himself has done. Hallelujah. Boldness and confidence. It takes boldness and confidence to start doing His works. It takes boldness and confidence to believe that when you begin to minister, the glory and the power of God is going to overwhelm everybody because you're in partnership with Him. And there's nothing disrupting that partnership. There's nothing that's got you out of agreement or out of alignment with Him, because He's all your righteousness. He's all your holiness. Philippians chapter 3 and verse 9. The Lord says, Paul says, by the Lord Jesus Christ, he says, and I'll back up to verse 8 so that you can get it. He says, and doubtless I count all things lost, but for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count it but dung that I may win Christ and be found in Him, having not my own righteousness which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. God's righteousness, nothing less. That which is absolutely holy and acceptable, that which does not in any way fall short in the least little bit. Everything that God ever wanted and everything that God ever purposed, His will is fashioned in you because you agree with God and you recognize this wonderful thing that God did for us. Well, when Adam sinned, you inherited it even though you weren't there and agreed with it. When Christ Jesus obeyed, you and I inherited it simply because we agreed with Him. We just agreed with Him. I'm telling you, it takes a spirit of wisdom and revelation, doesn't it? Because so many people believe that they know this. And you need to lay hold of this. You know it when you live it. You know it when you can do it and when you can show it. Until then, you've heard it and it looks like you understand it. But when you go to write it out, it just doesn't flow quite so easy. Now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Now in the name of Jesus Christ, I bind every mind-blinding spirit right now in Jesus' name. Everything and every power that would oppose the word or the working of the Spirit of God that would try to hold back this wonderful life in Jesus Christ, in the name of the Most High God, in the name of Jesus, Satan, I bind your work and your filthy lies. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 3, verse 22-21. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and prophets. God's righteousness. God's righteousness. That which He possesses and which He has. Even the righteousness of God which is by faith in Jesus Christ, a righteousness now that has been given to us, imparted to us, that comes by the new creation, something that you and I now lay hold of, we have relationally. We're not shaken by it. And you'll never answer an altar call again for salvation.
Amen.
And no one will be able to take your uprightness again from you or your righteousness from you.
Amen.
Nothing will ever be able to condemn you or conflict you ever again.
Amen.
because he's all your righteousness and you see yourself there righteous and holy and acceptable rather than trying to be it and finding some problem and finding some fault. Father finds no fault in this covenant. He finds no problem. And if you do fail and if you do sin and if you do slip up because you haven't learned how to walk in his glory in a place where he'll keep you from slipping and he'll keep you from falling and he'll keep you from stumbling, all you have to do is say, Lord, forgive me, wash me in your blood. All you have to do is be willing to repent. All you got to do is be willing to call upon his name, and that righteousness that God has imparted to us, the righteousness of God, remains intact. It's not in any way disrupted. It doesn't diminish. It's not diminished. It's not diminished. Huh? You know, come on, people just they my goodness, if you get condemned in the meeting, what's it like for you on Monday afternoon? Well, I'll move you on into Wednesday morning, because people who don't have a diet of the word and a place of worship and praise and thanksgiving and a place of prayer, my goodness, by Wednesday morning you basically weak, you hadn't eaten for 3 days. Right? Sunday was the last big meal. Sunday was the last divine interaction. You running out, and 3 days is a hard day, hardest day in the fast. It is. People just always having a three-dayer. Sunday to Wednesday, Wednesday to Sunday. Sunday to Wednesday, Wednesday. Come on, we will break the habit. Get you. Listen, there's a place God's called us to, a consecration. We all have to deal with it. We all have to see it. It's always there. We've got to say, no, I'm not interested. You know, you go on to do something, you know, that is wholesome and right and on the internet, and all of a sudden something flashes up, say you may be interested. No, I'm not interested. Delete. That is just simply demonic. Satan's got his lies coming right, left, and center. There's a consecrated lie. A place, a privilege, a divine privilege that we get to house God, that my heart is his royal throne, that I get to learn to walk in all of his ways, that I get to, throughout all of this process, throughout all of this journey, throughout all of this life, I stand before him unreprovable, unrebukable, without blemish in his sight. Three hallelujahs, five stares, one clap, and a handshake. Two turtle doves, one French hen. Come on, people. Come on, people. Grab a hold of God. Come on, grab a hold of God. Come on, grab a hold of God. Come on, grab a hold of God. Lay a hold on God. I'm sitting here talking to you about being blameless, and you're going... about having God's righteousness and God's holiness in your life. That is the look of, I don't get it. That is the look of, I don't get it. Because when you get it, something begins to stir on the inside of you. Amen. You don't get this. Because you intellectually can think about it. You get this because out of a fellowship, a divine revelation fills you and it explodes on the inside of you. And I'm going to keep talking to you. And the more you say amen, and the more you say it's mine, and the more you say I'm going to have it, I'm going to tell you right now, God who knows it all said that you have to speak it to have it. God said you have to speak it. He said you sit there and think about it, it's yours. No. God knows how this works. You don't. You speak it, hallelujah. 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 You need to walk around and tell God, thank him so much for how much he loves you. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank him so much for how perfect he made you. Hallelujah. How complete you are, how good of a job he did. God, your work is good. Yes. Good job. Yes. You know, if you're around me and I see a sunset, it doesn't matter what kind of sunset, I'm like, excellent job, Father. Or anything. Wow, amazing, God. Look at myself. Lord, you did it right. Come on. If you're not doing that. You're looking at the wrong thing. You're in the wrong covenant. It's about time you start speaking and acting, getting excited about what all God's done for you, because it's beyond all your imagination. It still goes beyond all that you can think or ask, even though you've read the Bible 1,000 times. Hallelujah. Truth without the Spirit, huh, is legalism. You listen to me. You're going to have the ministry of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I was made righteous freely by Christ Jesus.
Amen. Me too.
Everybody's sinned. Everybody's sinned comes short of the glory, but I was made righteous freely by Jesus. Yes. Hallelujah. Freely. Freely. Hallelujah. I came to the altar of the cross called Calvary, where the Lamb was sacrificed for me, and I put my sin on Him. And He put His righteousness on me. I put my guilt and shame on Him. He put His innocence and acceptance on me. Hallelujah. This is worship. This is why I get excited while everybody else is going. I'm not here excited because it happened. I see it. I taste it. I don't care what song we're singing. I'm in it. Because I'm not singing into the air. I'm not singing to you. I'm not singing to me. I'm not doing some religious little ditty. I'm talking about my Redeemer, who redeemed my life from destruction, who crowned me with His loving kindness and tender mercy, who put His holiness upon me. I'm not threatened. I'm not threatened by God saying, "Be holy even as I am holy." I'm like, yes, hallelujah. No problem, because I've received His holiness. I've been created anew in Christ Jesus in righteousness and true holiness. I'm His and He's mine. My whole existence is in Him. It's easy to see you and see your fault and see your problems and see your issues when you fall. But you just see the cross when you fall, when you stumble, when you slip, because you've not learned how to abide in this relationship. These people just see the cross. Just look into the altar and finish your faith. Just go to Him and see that wonderful completeness of that which He produces and gives to us freely. The same as He did at the beginning, He'll do it again and 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 again. And again and again and again and again and again. And again 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 and again. Why? Because His mercy rejoices over judgment, even though you may be convinced that justice should be served. Judgment without mercy is justice. But what God has provided for me and you in Jesus. I'm about to be translated. I don't know if I'm going to stay around. I feel like I'm starting to go away. I feel like I'm in the disappear mode right now. Hallelujah. Romande in the putanasi kalimahate. I'm going to be presented before Him with all joy, with all confidence, and with all boldness, because as He is, so am I right now. Hallelujah. I'm not trying to get it. I'm not trying to earn it. I'm not trying to hope that I'm going to be it someday. I received it as a free gift of divine grace and favor poured out lavishly upon me by that wonderful work at Calvary's tree. You can't have it any other way. Hallelujah. Well, I'm going to live it so I can show it. I'm going to live a consecrated life under the conviction of the Holy Ghost so that everybody else can be under conviction too. That conviction says, I am redeemed. I am the righteousness of God. I'm holy as He is holy. I'm established in His way to live fully for Him. That's that conviction. place where no sin is to exist, no evil, no undoneness, no wickedness, no iniquity. I'm staying in His Holy Ghost conviction. All the old things passed away. Everything new has come. And it's all of God. All I have is God. All I have is God. All I have is God's life, God's ways, God's work, His finished creation. It's done. I've come into the rest. People say, are you going to keep the Sabbath? Absolutely. Every day, 24 hours a day. I'm in the rest. I'm in the finished work. I'm in that which God said, it is good. It's good. I find no fault. I find no fault. This is exactly what I was looking for. This will work. This will do it now and forever. Amen. Go ahead and shout. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. No, it's just so good, people. This is where the battle is fought and won. This is the weapons of our warfare, which are mighty. This is an undefiled conscience. This is a good confession. Hallelujah. This is the faith that cannot be breached by the powers of darkness. This is knowing and believing the love that God has for us. God is love. He that dwells in this love dwells in God, that you may have boldness in the day of judgment. For as He is, so are we. We responded to the invitation. He says, come live with me. Come sit at the table with the mighty. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, Elijah got it the same way. Elijah got it the same way. Moses got it the same way. Abel got it the same way. Abraham got it the same way. They just got it in advance. They got it in advance, looking forward to the day. We've got it already. It's finished. It's settled. It's done. It's established. It's ours. It's done. Nothing can reverse it. God is blessed and nothing can reverse it. God has blessed me with His very own life and nothing can reverse it. Hallelujah. Nothing can reverse it. Doesn't mean to say that I can't walk away. You can. The unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. But I'm talking about a fellowship and a relationship that you don't want to walk away. It's just too good. It's just too good. I want to take you over, just look for with me real quickly at the ministry of the Holy Ghost. I want you to hear the ministry of the Holy Ghost. Ministry of the Holy Ghost is saying, you're righteous. Hallelujah. 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 There's a lot of people that are steeped in false doctrine and lies, running around saying we all unrighteous. It's so sad. So sad. Sinners. Undone. Unrighteous. Unholy. Unworthy. On and on. Lower than a worm's belly. On and on. On and on it goes. On and on. That's not the ministry of the Holy Ghost. Ministry of the Holy Spirit is this. He says to us in verse 8, and of course, 2 Corinthians chapter 3 is one of those explosive chapters that you can spend your life just looking at it going, what? Whoa. Unbelievable. You got to be kidding me. Amazing. I'm a living oracle, a living epistle written of God. For His ways and His glory and His nature and His being is established, written in me, given to me, created a new earth. A new heaven! This is where boldness and faith and confidence comes from. This is where vision comes from. This is where divine skills and divine ability is developed. This is where Satan has to listen to everything you've got to say. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I guarantee you hell knows my name. Hallelujah. I guarantee ya.
Hallelujah. Those of you who have like precious faith, who have such confidence in what Jesus did, not what you did, but what God has given. Your name is known as well. Hallelujah. Because we have a new name in Him. This is the victory that overcomes the world right over here. This is the victory. This is the overcoming power that overcomes everything that Satan could possibly ever throw at you. Every offense that could ever be launched against you. Every lying imagination. Every poverty spirit. Every sick spirit. Every disease spirit. Everything that looks incurable. This is the cure. This is the solution. This is a divine provision. I tell you, redemption looks like a certain thing. And you want to know that you have it. Yes. People are losing the redemption all the time. You're never going to be right until you're redeemed. Redemption, the redeemed of the Lord return and come with singing and the Zion and everlasting joy is upon their face. They have obtained gladness and joy, and all sorrow and sighing fled away. Are you in sorrow and sighing? Are you discouraged? Are you disappointed? Are you overwhelmed? You've listened to a lie. You listened to a lie. It's time to hear the truth, because you're going to rejoice. Yeah. Can you share, boo, I'm telling you, this is a better Christmas present than you'll ever get the rest of your life. Gold cannot buy this one. Oh, all the gold and all the silver, you were not redeemed with corruptible things. But this redemption came with the precious blood of God as a lamb. As a lamb sacrifice held in your hand, that you may impart your guilt and shame and sin upon it, that its innocence may be yours. The transference of life, the exchange of spiritual states. I'm about to disappear. I think I'm going to disappear. I'm about to explode. It's all I can do to be sober here tonight. Expecting that this place called the abiding place, this church that God lit up, will light up with divine confidence and boldness and assurance that it don't matter what comes. It doesn't matter what principality and powers and darkness or angels or things present or things absent or things here in this world or under the world. It doesn't matter. Nothing can separate me from this love, from this confidence, from this assurance, from this boldness, from this partnership of divine authority. Hallelujah. Mandalay Kashia. You can decide if you want not to be tormented anymore. Tonight, hallelujah. If you do not want to be tormented and harassed mentally anymore, hallelujah, we got your cure. If you don't want to feel like a failure and undone and a loser and a mess up and you're worn out and you can't believe it because you can't keep up and it just seems to be too much, I got the end of your crisis. I got the end of your crisis. Hallelujah. I got your cure for your disease. For your mental disease, I got your cure. Hallelujah. 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 Take another sip of communion. Sweet. That's another sip of righteousness, another sip of fellowship, another sip of holiness, another sip of endowment of power from on high, another sip of acceptable unto God, another sip of holy, another sip of the unrebukable, unblameable, another sip of without blemish, another sip of come on in, you belong here. Another sip of oneness with God. Not undoneness. Amen. Oneness. Amen. Not undoneness. Amen. Oneness. Say it. Not undoneness. Amen. Oneness. Not undoneness. Oneness. Not undoneness. Oneness. Not undoneness. Oneness. Woo! Hallelujah.
Hallelujah! Lord, let the flood tide roll. Lord, let the flood tide flow.
Oh God, hallelujah. I promise you. I promise you. I promise you, in this place, in confidence towards God, it is like a flood of water that covers the earth. It is like a tsunami that comes and sweeps over the west coast and floods it all with the glory of the Lord. Santeo.
Nindam Rosite. You can be seated just a minute. Just seated with me just a minute.
I know I probably couldn't sit down either.
Oh. Until you stand before the Lord like this, you can never find the place of walking with Him in fellowship. You'll always sense you'll find an undoneness and a failure and a disappointment and an overwhelming thing that Satan comes in and manipulates and gains ground in your life. But he cannot penetrate the blood. He cannot penetrate the righteousness of God. He cannot penetrate the holiness of God. The confidence comes, the convincing comes, that results in a consecration, a Holy Ghost conviction, a set apartness that says, no, I have none of it. I will not do it. I'm walking over here in fellowship with the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost is saying, you're righteous. He's ministering. You, God's right. You, God's righteous. You, the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus.
There's just, you're just not going to let anything, you're not going to let that go. I promise you. It's just such an emboldening, wonderful, fulfilling thing. It's an acceptance that you don't ever want to leave. When you feel rejected, it's hard to come around. It's hard to come around when you feel like somebody's disappointed with you, don't like you. There's kind of been talking about you when you were absent, talking about your failings and the things that you didn't do that you said you would do. Oh, hear me now. Come on. It's not happening in the kingdom of God. It's not going on in the realms of this glorious fellowship with Him. Hallelujah. Look at the ministry of the Spirit. Look at what God the Holy Ghost is doing. And I know it's just so hard for me to break in. Anytime, 2 Corinthians chapter 3 is so dear to me. I have a very difficult time just landing on a verse of scripture right in the big middle of all of this. It's difficult. He says, do we begin again, verse 1, to commend ourselves, or need we? Epistles of commendation or letters of commendation from you? You are epistles written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as you are manifestly declared to be the epistles of Christ, you are the living testimony of the life and ministry of the person Jesus. You didn't earn it. You can't earn it. You cannot achieve that kind of ability. You can't somehow be good enough one day to have the Lord say that this is yours. It's a free gift that comes to anyone who receives an authority to be sons of God. Amen. Simple by reception. Amen. To walk in this wonderful realm of the life of Jesus. Oh, what wonderful, wonderful grace. Oh, what wonderful, wonderful grace. The goodness of God extended to me according to His own good pleasure. That which God is willing to bestow upon all men. The very measure, the measureless measure without measure, the measure of Christ. the fullness of all that God himself possesses and all that he has and all that he's ever wanted and all that is acceptable and all that he delights in and all that he is blessed with and all that he says, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased, all that pleases him, given to us, endowed to us, to where that we stand before him blameless, without sin, without iniquity. Unto him who loved us and washed us, loosed us from our sins in his own blood, and made us priests and kings, having purified himself a people from all iniquity, the treasured people, priests and kings, that are zealous of good works. Amazing God. Amazing God. Amazing God. And you know, it just goes on to say so many wonderful things here. But in verse 8 it says, how shall not the ministry of the Spirit be rather glorious? He's talking about the glory of the ministry that took place in the fellowship relationship that Moses got to have with God. His relational interaction, relational righteousness, if you would, resulted in ethical righteousness. That relational righteousness that he had, where God allowed him to see what no man can see and live. Amen. You know, you can translate Isaiah saying that he saw only the hem of God's garments, and was overwhelmed, saying, I see the Lord. I see his glory, and the hem of his garment fills the temple. And there he finds himself overwhelmed with his holiness and overwhelmed with his righteousness, in need of it. And the Lord immediately sends righteousness and holiness and says, your iniquity is taken away from you. Your unrighteousness, your unholiness is removed from off of you. And now look at what happens. Now he's bold. I'll go. I'll do it. I'll go on your behalf and speak on your behalf. Look at the boldness. Look at the authority that comes when all the sin and all the iniquity is taken away. And now you get to stand, not based upon anything that you and I have done, but because of the gift of God, stand before him, having everything that is pleasing and holy and righteous and acceptable to him. What empowerment. And that's what the ministry So the ministry of Moses in that relationship, as he beholds God's glory and he gets to see Father from the back. He gets to get a glimpse. He got a glimpse of him from the back, from his back. He got a glimpse. Because the Lord just put his hand over his face and gave him a glimpse and cried out. And as he saw the glory, God cried out as he saw the glory, I am merciful. I have long suffering. I'm full of compassion. I'm full of goodness and faithfulness. You want to see my glory? You want to see who I am? He, you know, listen to that. Listen to the display of who he is, the lavish affection that he pours out upon Moses as he reveals to Moses who he is, how tender he is, how merciful, how good, how faithful he is, how willing he is to do whatever we need for him to do. And Moses' face lit up. His face glowed until he died. His face glowed from one encounter until he died. They had to put a veil over him. And the veil was put over him because his face glowing looked like the new covenant. His face glowing looked like the new covenant. That looked like the new covenant. Hallelujah. That looked like the new covenant. I'm promising you people, if you'll begin to believe God's love for you and begin to understand that you stand before him not with your righteousness but with his righteousness, no matter when you fail, you stand with him with his righteousness and with his holiness. I'm telling you, your face is going to light up. Your boldness is going to blow up. And I'm going to tell you, you're going to have a confidence to go up into the realms of divine power and glory and be used by God in a way that goes beyond anything that you could have ever imagined. On everything you can imagine. Hallelujah. 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 And then he says in verse 9, now look at now, he's going to talk the ministry of Spirit, and he's going to couple the ministry of the Holy Spirit with something here. He says, for if the ministry of condemnation was glory, the ministry of condemnation, that's what lit up Moses' face. God says, draw not nigh. You're unacceptable to me. There wasn't a lamb provided for their sin to be transferred to. There wasn't an innocent lamb of God where God himself becomes a sacrifice, and God in all of his holiness, and God in all of his righteousness, and God in all of his purity says, now lay your sin upon me and I'll lay my holiness upon you and my righteousness upon you. I'll exchange my life for your life. That had not been provided. So God said, you can't come in. You cannot draw nigh to me. You cannot come near unto me. The only one who can come near to me is one that I will give grace and impart the ability ahead of time on account of what God will do in the future, which he accomplished in Christ Jesus. I came to Jesus and I laid my sin on him and I laid my guilt on him and I laid my undoneness on him. And I received his righteousness and his holiness. And his innocence and his purity. And it's of him and not of me. It's his. And my whole confidence and faith is forever in him. And that's why I don't weary. And that's why I don't tire. And that's why I don't feel like it's too much. Because it's done deal. It's mine. It's a gift. It's my Christmas present. From heaven. Hallelujah. I ride around on it. Hallelujah. I glide around on it. I enjoy it. I feast on it. Hallelujah. I stare at it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I must tell you, I'm deeply moved by it. It is the source of my song. Hallelujah. It's the source of my praise. It's the source of my thanksgiving. It's the source of my dance. It's the source of my obedience. It's the source of my commitment. It's the source of my consecration. It's the source of my sanctification. It's the source of my fellowship. It's the source of why I'm not going to disobey him. I'm on a walk with him. What a God. What a great God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Even in the ministry of condemnation, there he is seated, enthroned upon the mercy seat. Even though he's saying only one man can come here that I give grace to and sanctify to draw near unto me. A place where I will meet with men, a place of mercy. God says a place of mercy. My mercy is always going to rejoice over my judgment. A place where I'll meet with men. Oh my. You know, that's why I didn't read it, but that's why the Lord says to us, and if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father, the mercy seat, Christ Jesus the righteous, the mercy seat, the propitiation. It is a word that is really mistranslated many times. It's the pakura, it's a kapurit. It is that mercy seat. It's God's chair, the chair that he sits in. So what does he sit in? The seat of judgment. One day he will. Right now he sits in the seat of mercy. One day he'll sit in the seat of judgment, all heaven and earth will flee from him. Because men would have said no to him, rejected his love, and rejected his goodness one too many times. And his wrath is going to be poured out upon sin and iniquity because he hates it worse than anybody else does who's been violated. You get violated, somebody do something bad to you, and you're going to want justice. There ain't going to be hardly any mercy there. Your judgment is going to want justice. Then when God wants it, when God establishes it, when it's all about God's kingdom, suddenly all of a sudden it's unrighteous and it's not right. No, it is right. He's just and good and merciful. All of his ways are right, true. And everything he's spoken is for our life and for our blessing and for our benefit. And just because we want God on our own terms doesn't mean that that's right. We want God on his terms because he alone knows what is right and knows what is good. And I want it that way. I don't want it any other way. If the ministry of condemnation was glorious, how much more the ministry, look at here, the ministry of righteousness exceeds in glory. Hear what the Holy Spirit, see, that's paired with the ministry of the Holy Spirit in verse 8. We live in the ministry of the Holy Spirit, which is rather glorious, and that is paired with the ministry of righteousness, which exceeds in glory. And what the Holy Spirit is saying, you righteous, He's revealing Jesus. He's saying you all your whole life and all that you are and all that you have and all that Father sees you as and all that you exist in is Christ Jesus. He's here to reveal Jesus to us and through us. And that's all, the cornerstone of it. That the authority of it, the empowerment of it, is knowing that I have His righteousness, that I have His holiness, that I'm accepted in the Beloved. I'm accepted in Him. Jesus is the Beloved. I and you accepted in the Beloved. Hallelujah. We're not accepted on the basis of who we are. Get over yourself. You got something far better. You came to the altar. You transferred your sin and shame and guilt to the Lamb. And He transferred His righteousness, holiness, and purity. Innocence. Hallelujah. The just for the unjust. The righteous for the sinner. How glorious God is to us. How wonderful He is. How amazing He is. When you look here, and of course, if you go on in chapter 3, you're going to end up, and I hate to leave chapter 3 at all, but I just want to just kind of minister these things to you real quickly. Let you spend some time just worshiping the Lord over it, thanking Him for His goodness. When you read a verse of scripture, pretty much as you grow and mature, you got to get up and dance around for a while. And shout and praise God, hallelujah. And then you can come back to the next verse. Because it just do. It's spirit, it's life, it's truth, it's reality, it's living. And it becomes to you insight and revelation and communion and fellowship. It activates within you all that God has given. It's His word. Hallelujah. And I want you to get into this realm. I want you to leave natural, earthly, lust, and demonic stuff behind. Come over here and start fellowshipping with the divine. Come over here, get into the good thing. Get into the life of God. Hallelujah. Now you can see just how demonic and how crazy and how evil it is for people, and especially as you hear it in Southern California and many other places, where they're just saying we're all unrighteous and we're all sinners and we're all undone. That's how I see how evil it is. So how anti-God it is, how anti-redemption it is, how anti-faith it is. It goes contrary to the whole of the Bible. Not just one or two verses, a couple of chapters, in the whole of faith and confidence of redemption is assaulted with such lies. So men stay in the bondage of sin and darkness and deception, accepting something that was propagated by Satan himself right out of the realms of hell. And, you know, I want you to look quickly with me at Philippians chapter 2. God is so good. I'm the righteousness of God. I'm holy as He is holy. See, you know, it's so amazing. You know, God says, be holy even as I'm holy. But you have very few people respond and say, yes, Lord, I'll be holy even as You're holy. Very few people. Oh, they're saying they're preaching the truth. They're saying they're obeying God, but they're not. They're denying Him, not only with works, but even verbally. God says, be righteous even as I'm righteous. And very few people will respond and say, I'm righteous. I will be righteous even as You're righteous. They're intimidated by it because they're trying to do it through human effort and through human ability and not receiving the gift that God has given us where He's empowered us to be. When He said to the sun, be. When He said to the galaxies, be. When He said to the universe, be. It became. It existed. The same God has spoken to you and me and said, be holy. Be righteous. Hallelujah. 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 You know, the healing power of the Spirit of God is here tonight. You know, it's a wonderful thing to be in the church as we're ministering the Word of God and know that there's the working of miracles and the gifts of healing. And so somebody tonight, and you may be in here, you may actually be watching me on the web, but a disease started setting into your hip, right into your hip bone. And I'm telling you right now, the power of God, the power that is in the name of Jesus Christ, this wonderful provision that has come to us right out of the realms of heaven, come touches you right now. Amen. Heals you right now. Praise the name of Jesus. That foul, tormenting, afflicting thing goes from you in Jesus' name. Amen. I command it to depart out of your body and obey me. Amen. Hallelujah. And see, you know, I don't have to do that based upon whether or not I think that God, how I think God feels about me, because I understand how God feels about me. I'm in Christ Jesus and He's in me. And so therefore, He feels about me the way He feels about His only begotten Son. We got a full revelation on that. Amen. If you want to be able to hear Jesus, to God the Father, tell you every day, this is my beloved child in whom I'm well pleased, then all you got to do is go ahead and find yourself existing in Jesus, and you can hear Father say it to Him. And that's why the Lord tells us over and again, He identifies Himself in us, and He identifies us in Himself. And He says that we're raised up together with Him, that we're crucified with Him, that we're buried with Him by baptism into His death, that we're raised up together with Him, that we're alive together with Him, that we're seated in a heavenly realm with Him. And wherever He is, there we are, that He's the vine and we're the branch, and we're producing the fruit by the sap of the Holy Ghost that is supplied to us, and the workmanship of the Father that develops us and cultivates us. Hallelujah. You don't walk up to a vine and go, my goodness, you vine, you pathetic vine, can't you do better than that on your fruit? You go to the husbandman and say, don't you know how to cultivate? You're not going to lay such a charge against Father. He's the best cultivator. Hallelujah. Just stay in the branch. Just stay in the vine. Be a branch that just stays in the vine. In Philippians, and try to get over there real quickly. I'm just asking you, does the Lord delight in you?
Yes.
Why is that? Because you in Him and He's in you. Because you everything He's ever wanted man to be. How can you be that? Because you've accepted the life of Christ Jesus. You laid your sin upon Him, and He laid His righteousness upon you. You gave your life to Him, and He gave His life to you. So now that you can find yourself no longer undone. If you're undone, you need redemption. If you're not right with God, you need redemption. If you're not righteous, you need redemption. If you're not acceptable to God, you need redemption. If you feel separated or distanced from God, you need redemption. And I pray that you'll come and evermore eat this bread, and evermore drink this water, and evermore drink this cup. Hallelujah. I pray in the name of Jesus tonight that your eyes of your understanding is open. And never will you be deceived by a lie again. Never will you be discouraged or listen to ministering spirits of darkness that does not minister righteousness, that does not minister glory, but rather ministers condemnation and shame. I mean, if I would continued on a course in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, the Lord says that the Spirit of the Lord has brought to us this freedom and this glory so that we look into a mirror with an unveiled face and we behold the glory of God. We behold the image of God. When we see ourselves, we see Him. Because we found all our life in Him and exist in Him. And there when we look in the mirror and we see Him instead of us,
amen,
we changed.
Amen.
From glory to glory and the continual excelling of. Hallelujah. And it's not just from one covenant to another. It's this ongoing, every dimension of God being unveiled to us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me. Ah, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
Philippians. Try to get there. Can. I'm having a hard time. Chapter 2, verse 17. You know, when you just feel good. Hallelujah. Even people who feel bad start feeling good after a while being around you. And when you are accepted and beloved, and when you are good, when you're made good, hallelujah, you know, then you can give yourself to goodness. Yeah. You know, you can't give yourself to all these things that God tells us to give ourselves to, the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, and peace, when you're feeling all undone and unworthy and unacceptable and unholy. You just can't. But when you have everything that belongs to Him because you've inherited it as a son, it's like, okay, what are we going to do today? Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. This is where heavenly vision is born. This is where faith has developed and grows and is strengthened. This is where you have a confidence to be able to start up on the start down in the lower part of California on the border of Tijuana. And then see Father move you into a place of influence in northern Washington. And then you just start seeing a strategy from heaven. Of one meeting after the next meeting, all the way down the coast. One meeting after the next meeting, all the way down the coast. As God begins to gather an army, as God begins to gather listening ears, and then one meeting after another meeting again as you go back up the coast. One meeting after another again as the proclamation, the faith, and the word, and the confidence of what God is about to do comes exploding out of you. Till you get all the way to the northern region again, and then you start all over again, and back down the coast you come. As this word of life, as the word of authority, as the word of the Lord, as a confidence and a boldness begins to spring up, as faith is being executed through our life, as a diligence and a consecration and a commitment to be in agreement with what Father wants to do in the place, a hunger and a passion to see His glory manifested, to see the powers of darkness that blinds men's eyes and understanding broken. Yes. To the whole place, some of the most wicked states in the United States of America, right here in the Western United States, suddenly explode with the glory and the presence of the living God. Can it happen? 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 If a Jesuit priest can dedicate his life and risk his life on every turn of the road and go up and down the coast from California to Canada and back again, propagating all of their religion and their doctrine, could there not be someone bought with a price, redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, empowered by God with His divine life and goodness and authority of His Spirit, begin to move and see that which God has purposed, fulfilled? This is what we're going to do. And this is where it's done. Right here. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. And I want to encourage you that those of you that are laboring, you've been laboring all day. Many of you have been laboring all day. Gone and picked up people, kids for Sunday school this morning for the children's ministry. You labored on the streets. You've labored in ministry. Listen, I'm telling you right now, this is where the labor is the battlefront. It's the battlefront for souls. And that, I promise you, is going to be rewarded. It is not for one second unacknowledged or missed by God. His eyes are fixed on it. You believe me. Father's eyes are fixed on it. He's looking at you. He's going, really?
Amen.
How do you feel about the relationship now? Are you into this?
Yes.
He's hearing what's coming out of your mouth. He's seeing the consecration. When you begin to go after the lost, you get Father's attention, His eyes fixed on you. Because He sees somebody now taking that which He has so richly blessed us with and now allowing it to produce within our life His power, His authority, His work of divine grace.
the manifestation of his person. Oh, if there's anything we want to see developed in our life, it's compassion and long-suffering, mercy, full of goodness, full of faithfulness, because that's who he is, and he wants to be manifested through our lives. It is the sum total in many respects of his righteousness and of his holiness being revealed. It is the expression of his divine love from which all of these things flow like streams. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
From the fountain of life. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. We're going to be tempted. We're going to have to deal with temptation. We're going to have to deal with assailing thoughts. We're going to have to deal with lying, condemning spirits for the rest of our lives. The reality of it is, if we'll walk with God the way he's purposed us to walk, we'll become very effective at taking out whole hordes of devils.
Amen.
At one shot.
Amen. Hallelujah.
To go from just some little harassing, tormenting thought ailing you to being able to cast out devils in mass as hundreds of thousands of people gathered to hear the word of God right here in the United States of America.
Amen.
You know, somebody said, I agreed with somebody the other day. I said, yeah, I believe the Lord has brought reprieve to America through this new administration because of what's happening with the Supreme Court and the people that are being appointed, that there's going to be a similitude of godliness, but that doesn't mean that it's going to be smooth sailing, because we prayed for the quickest approach to bring the nation to its knees to result in being the new administration in the White House. I'm telling you right now, people think it's all going to get better. I'm going to tell you right now, it is. From a spiritual perspective, I believe there'll be thousands and tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands hungry to hear the word of God in the Western United States. I'm looking for it. I'm being prepared by God for it. So are you. That's why you're here tonight. That's why you're hearing these things. And those of you who are willing to hear God and lay hold on it, yeah, it's going to be challenged. But so what? That's the good fight of faith. You've got to grab a hold of the word of God, meditate on these things, go look up these verses of scripture, look at them, stare them down long enough until you've actually memorized it without even trying.
Yes. Yes.
That's what happens. You stare at it long enough and you begin to meditate on it long enough and it becomes such a part of you, you memorize it without even trying. It becomes integrated into your being and it becomes activated in your life. And you get excited about it, you rejoice about it. And then every time you worship God and praise him, it gets stronger. Every time you give thanks to him, it becomes more effective in your life. It just all begins to grow out and develop in our lives, this outworking of what he did for us. When he gave to us this unspeakable gift of his life, of his godliness, of his goodness. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's no problem to live in righteousness and godliness when you've got his holiness and righteousness.
Amen.
And godliness. And there's no law problem to be pure even as he's pure. Hallelujah. To walk even as he walks. To be as he is in this life. No problem to be holy as he's holy. To be righteous even as he is righteous. No problem. It's been given to me. Hallelujah. It's been given to you. So I want to encourage you, people, honestly. Every time you read the Bible, it's strengthened. Every time you praise, it grows. Every time you worship, it becomes a stronger reality. The spirit of wisdom and revelation causes you to mature in it. Hang on, man, it's going to get really good from here. The view continually gets better.
Yes.
I can take you up some places and you'll say, when we first start off on the walk, just 5 minutes in, you'll go, wow, this is amazing. I'll say, the view will continually get better from now for the next 5 hours. As you linger and look and see all that God has done in creation. Oh, as you linger, as you look and as you see all that God has done for you in Christ Jesus. And that's what the revelation and the insight and the knowledge of his word brings to those who meditate on it, who find themselves communing with it, eating it, devouring it, coming to the word for strength, for ability, for insight. Hallelujah. This bread of heaven. this bread of heaven. Hallelujah. Philippians 2:17. Not the word. This is it. It must not be Philippians. It was Philippians 2:17. And it's not. 2:15 is a great verse of scripture. But it's not the one I wanted to give. I'll read it. It's perfect. Let's just read it right. The Lord tells us that we may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation among whom we shine as lights in the world, only because, you know, we've accepted what God has said, what he's done for us. No, you know, I'll find it here in a minute. It says, the scripture says, we be found sinners. Is Christ then the minister of sin? Oh, I know what my problem is. I'm supposed to be in Galatians. Philippians 3:9, I think I've already given to you. Okay, I'm just missing. Here we go. I'm like, Paul said that to the church of Galatia, not Philippi. You know what reminded me of it was his conflict with Peter that he had there in Galatians chapter 2. And Galatians chapter 2, verse 17, there we go. But if while we seek to be made righteous in Christ, while we seek to be justified in Christ, while we seek to be those who are righteous through Christ Jesus, is another good way to translate that. If we are found sinners, is therefore Christ the minister of sin? There is absolutely no way. You can't be made righteous in Christ Jesus, can't be justified by him, and still be found a sinner. You read that it found, as we have said to you and ministered to you tonight, with just some highlight verses of scripture. Once you come and receive what Christ Jesus has to give to us, when you've been justified by him, you've been made the righteousness of God. You've received his life. You've been made a new creation. Old things have passed away. You've been redeemed. You received redemption, the removal of all sin. This is the new covenant in my blood, which is given to you to erase sin. Erase, divine eraser. It never existed. Canceled, obliterated, abolished. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Removed far from you to remember them no more. The new covenant that remembers them no more and just focuses on establishing you and me in all the ways of his divine glory and nature and power and splendor and majesty.
Amen.
Everybody stand with me, please. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say, Lord, you are my righteousness.
Lord, you are my righteousness.
I turn my heart towards you.
And worship you.
Lord, you are my righteousness.
Lord, you are my righteousness.
Turn my heart towards you.
Turn my heart towards you.
And worship you.
And worship you.
Lord, you are my righteousness. And I turn my heart towards you.
I turn my heart towards you.
And worship you.
And worship you.
I worship you.
I worship you.
Jesus Christ, my Lord. All my life is hidden you.
All my life is hidden you.
I live this life you given and worship you.
I live this life you given and worship you.
Now I want you to sing it with me. All my life is in you. I turn my life to you and worship you. Lord, all my life is hidden you. I live my life in you and worship you. I worship you. Oh, Jesus Christ, my Lord. Come play. All your blood has cleansed me, Jesus Christ, my Lord, I worship you. All your blood that cleanses me, oh, Jesus Christ, my Lord, I worship you. All your blood that cleanses me, oh, Jesus Christ, my Lord, I worship you. I worship you. Oh, Jesus Christ, my Lord. Lord, you're all my holiness. I give my life to you and worship you. Lord, you're all my holiness, and I give my life to you and worship you. Lord, you're all my holiness, and I give my life to you and worship you. Oh, I worship you. Oh, Jesus Christ, my Lord, and I stand complete in you, blameless without offense, and worship. Oh, I stand complete in you, blameless without offense, and worship you. Lord, I stand complete in you, blameless without offense, and worship you. Oh, I worship you. Oh, Jesus Christ, my Lord. I'm everything you want, all that you desired, and I worship you. Say it now. I'm everything you want, and all that you desired, and I worship you. Lord, I'm everything you want, and all that you desired, and I worship you. Oh, I worship you, Jesus Christ, my Lord. I have your righteousness, I have your holiness, and I worship you. Isn't it wonderful? I have your righteousness, I have your holiness, and I worship you. Lord, I have your righteousness, and I have your holiness, and I worship Christ the Lord. Oh, I worship Christ, my Lord. I live my life in you, for all that you have you given, and I worship you. I live my life in you.
I live my life in you. For all that you have, you given, and I worship.
People, you're going to step into something that is so glorious that you can't even imagine.
I live my life in you. I have all that you've given, and I worship you. Oh, I worship Jesus Christ.
Jews said to Jesus, they said, what sign will you do? Moses gave to our fathers bread in the wilderness.
Jesus said, Moses didn't give your fathers the true bread.
He said, I am the bread of heaven. Anyone who eats this bread shall live forever.
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes on me shall not die, but shall have the light of life on the inside, the resurrection life on the inside.
We're getting ready now here to just get all of our perspectives right as we take a hold of this communion, as we take a hold of this bread.
When Jesus said, this is my body, which I give for you. He's telling us of the redemption that comes by the impartation of his life to you and me. He's telling us of the exchange that now his life, his being, is ours. That everything that belonged to us formerly, that we inherited from Adam, has completely been removed and taken away. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Everything that has been provided for us by God's Lamb, Christ Jesus, we've inherited it. It's now ours.
Hallelujah. Son, do the song you're doing this morning. You own my righteousness. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Let me just read this to you, okay? Jesus said, verily I say unto you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father has given it to you, the true bread. For the bread of God is he that cometh down from heaven, which gives his life for the world.
Gives his life actually to the world, to anybody who received. Tonight I pray in the name of Jesus that you do not walk out of here living your own life, interacting with God based upon your own failures and successes, based upon your own concepts of righteousness and works and holiness, but you'll find everything that you are and all your acceptance in God by what Christ Jesus has imparted and what he's given, and there now be released in the freedom and the ability to develop in all that he has demanded.
Then they said unto him, Lord, forevermore give us this bread.
Jesus said, I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger. And he that believes on me shall never thirst.
Because he's continually supplying bread. He's continually supplying drink. Because we can there find ourselves continually living by him. That's why the fellowship or the communion, no matter what goes on, we always just turn to him and take another sip and have another bite. And say, look at what he did for me, and look at what he imparted, and look at what he gave. And now I live by him, and all my life is in. Outside of him is condemnation, but in him is acceptance. Outside of him is condemnation. Outside of him is shame. There needs to be no more sacrifice. It's not a continual sacrifice that we're offering. It's the continual remembrance of the sacrifice that was given and the life that was imparted that we have in Him.
Living.
I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. People are trying to think about dying, saying you're dead. Listen, you can't wrap your head and heart around that, but you can wrap your head and heart around that you live. And the life that you now live is the life of God. It's the life of Jesus. Hallelujah. Quit forget about the dying. Hallelujah. And get into the living. Hallelujah. Who wants to hang out in the graveyard? Think about the dying. The dying. Convalescent homes. Spiritual convalescent homes. Oh, it's time to come on over with the living. It is a place where everybody's healthy. Hallelujah. And filled with the goodness and the life of God. I said unto you, rather forgive me. I'll get it right here in a minute. But I said unto you that ye also have seen me and believe not. All that the Father gives me shall come to me. And him that comes to me I will in no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will, which has sent me, that all which he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again in the last day. That's me. That's me. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which sees the Son and believes on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up in the last day. Jesus goes on to say this. He says, verily, verily, I say to you, he that believes on me has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your father did eat manna in the wilderness. They are dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that if a man eat it, he will not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Jesus said, truly I tell you with absolute certainty, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoso eats this flesh and drinks this blood has eternal life. And I will raise him up at the last day. And once again, people, that's not the communion of the table. That's the communion of the sacrifice where you and I came to the Christ Jesus and we took our sin and we laid it upon him. And in exchange, we received the righteousness of God. Because there's some people, I believe, that they've come to the Lord Jesus to some degree and they've laid their sin upon him and they've asked him to forgive them of their sins, because it's the same thing from that pattern of sacrifice that we see in the Old Testament. When you're asking the Lord to forgive you of your sin, you're laying your sin upon a sacrifice, but they never received the righteousness of God. The exchange didn't take place. Come to the Lamb, the offering, and it's an exchange. And it's an exchange. It's an exchange. His life for you. It's the ministry of reconciliation that we read about there in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. The ministry of reconciliation is literally the ministry of exchange. Tonight I'm being to you, once again, a minister of reconciliation. And I'm saying, and I'm begging you, be reconciled to God. Have the exchange. And then, of course, then Paul highlights that and he says, in that same context, in verse 21, he said, because he became the sin offering. He became your sin offering. He became the place where your sin was transferred, that you may be made the righteousness of God in him. Tonight, If the transference is not taking place in your life, let it happen now. Come lay your sin on Him. Come fall upon the mercy seat. Come take your hands, as it were, and lay it upon your offering, upon your lamb. And confess your sins and cry out to Him. And say, "Here, take my sin now, and let it be accounted unto you. For He gladly bore our sins in His own body on the tree." So that now the exchange might take place, and the sin being removed, we might live under righteousness, having His life imparted unto us, His righteousness given to us, by whose wound we were also healed. I pray today, I cry out to God on your behalf, that you will understand this very simple thing, and God, the very basis of faith, that from this day forward, you'll grab a hold of the communion of the new covenant. Jesus says, "This is it. This is the new covenant. This is the new covenant that I give to you. The new covenant in my flesh." And He took the bread and He broke it. And He said, "This is my body, which I give for you." This is the transference, taking them back to every offering. This is the new covenant in my blood, which takes away all of your sin. And when the enemy comes at you, when situations come at you, when circumstances come at you, when things threaten your standing with God and who you are in Him, take another bite. Turn your heart towards your sacrifice, where your sin was laid upon Him, and the righteousness of God received. When something threatens you, take another sip. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I'm redeemed, oh, redeemed, His child, and forever I am. Everybody up here in this section, come. Just come. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, He took bread and He broke it and He said, "This is my body. Take it and eat it." He said, "This is the new covenant in my blood, which is given to you to remove all sin, to remove it." How can you take the covenant and still say that you have sinned? Brother, say, no, I am the life of God. His life has been given to me. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Love you, dear. Kingdom, look, sikarama, sitaikh, stikaname. Just be healed right now in Jesus' name. Be healed. Be made perfectly whole right now in the name of Jesus. Believe God for the greatest miracle you've ever encountered tonight. It's yours. The miracle is yours. Hallelujah. The covenant is yours. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your precious blood. Thank you for your body. Thank you for your life. Thank you for these good things that you provided through this wonderful sacrifice. Hallelujah. Hey, how are you? Bless you. What is your name? These are your children. Have you all given yourself to Jesus? I don't know you. I have to ask you these questions. Have you given yourself over to Christ Jesus? Huh? That's what you're here for? But that's good. Because this is all about communion with Him. The Lord says that we have to examine ourselves, because otherwise we eat and drink damnation, and we do it unworthily. But because you're saying, "Lord, I want your life. I want you to forgive me and wash me, cleanse me from my sin." Communion is yours. It's that easy. Isn't that wonderful? You've got to lay your sin on Him and receive His righteousness tonight. Do you understand that? Say, "Lord, I turn my back on sin." Say, "Lord Jesus,
Take hold of my life.
Wash me from my sin.
I take my sin, I lay it on you.
I grab a hold of your righteousness.
And it becomes mine.
I take hold of your life.
To now live for you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise the Karamoshitilina.
Hallelujah.
Blessed is the name of the Lord.
Mambanda lekena munjasa leya. Mambanda lekena barasa derinish. Kimbando ramonde rishande lekeli. Lekele maya. Lekena mombrosi.
Jesus. You're amazing. Father. You're amazing.
Say, I'm healed.
I'm healed.
Say, I'm filled.
I'm filled.
Say, I have every good thing.
I have every good thing.
I belong to the Lord.
I belong to the Lord.
He belongs to me.
He belongs to me.
I'm in Him.
I'm in Him.
And He's in me.
He's in me.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Ando Kaylee. Only Shana. Jesus.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Bless you.
Bless you.
This section right here is come. Do exploits. The body of God. The very body of God. This is my body. Eat this. Take my life into you. Live my life. Have my acceptance. Have my fullness. Have my power. Have my righteousness. Have my godliness. Have my holiness. Have my purity. Have my divine ability. Have my heaven. Have my work of grace. Have every good thing. Be blessed with every good thing. Walk in my power. Walk in my favor. Walk in my authority. Multiply. God, make you 10,000 times more. Lay hold on Jesus with both hands. Both hands. Both. Maritast. Brikta. Orstan. Renounce every unholy thing. Renounce every ungodly thing. Live for Him. Live for Jesus. Love you, Joseph. Live for Jesus. Live. Live. Die no more. Live. Live His life. Live in Him. This is the faith. Where you cease to exist, and it's no longer you that lives. That's what you accept. That's what you accept. You can't just lay your sin upon Him and not receive His righteousness and accept that the exchange was done, because you didn't go through with the full transaction. You laid your sin upon Him and walked away without the transaction.
Huh? I went into the store the other day and I bought something. And I got distracted and walked out without it. They came running out. Said, "You paid for this." It was an incomplete transaction. Tonight, let's have a complete meal. Be reconciled. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body." He now gets very appointed on the message that he had ministered in John chapter 6. It was the Lamb saying, "You get to eat the Lamb of communion by substitute of this bread." The Passover meal. The meal of deliverance. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your body. Thank you for the place where my sin was born. In your body, on the tree. Lord, I thank you that you allowed me to bring my sin and lay it upon you. I want you to say it. Say, "Lord,
Lord,
I thank you, that you allowed me to bring my sin and lay it upon you.
Take my life
and surrender it to you.
So that I might receive in exchange
your righteousness,
your holiness,
your purity,
your life.
Now I live by you." And that's what you're saying when you eat this bread. I'm living by him. And after that he supped, he took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. This is given to you for the remission of your sin." Their sin is completely wiped away. Once again, he taking our sins that we may receive his righteousness. And from this day forward, Lord, as you consecrated yourself for us, we consecrate ourselves to you, to live for you, to say no to sin, no to worldliness, no to ungodliness, no to every evil and unholy thing, to walk with you. Hallelujah. 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 Be healed right now. That's good. Be healed right now. Delicious. It's delicious, huh, Anna? It's delicious, huh? Tastes delicious, huh? As soon as I started saying delicious, Naomi started waking up. It's a delight to eat, eh? Good food. Let yourself be delighting all day in him. Huh? Don't be separated from the covenant. This is the fellowship. This is the communion. It's all about what he gave to us. It's all about us eating and drinking, us receiving, us taking it in. Amen. Hallelujah. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my holiness, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious is that love, oh, that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood. Lord, let all the work of redemption be found and realized within our lives. Father, in your mercy, Father, in your grace, cause our eyes to see, cause our ears to hear, cause our hearts to understand that from this day forward, we will live fully for you, God. Let the sound of the Spirit, let the sound of prophecy, let the sound of thanksgiving, let the voice of your own glory and your power be heard in the midst of your people in this place, oh God. Let there be signs, let there be wonders by your holy child, Jesus. Once you discover who you are in Him, you will not want to be anything else. Once you discover who you are in Him, you will not want to be anything else. There's no greater place of honor, no greater place of glory, no greater place of riches and splendor, no greater life, no greater excitement. And that which is found in Him, that which He's given us. Set your face to seek the Lord. Set your heart to know these things that you've heard here in this place. Do not let them slip. Do not let them slip. If someone comes to you 1 year from now and says, what was ministered? On December the 4th, you'll be able to say, December the 4th, 2016, I'll tell you what was ministered. Because I heard it and I did not let it slip. I grabbed a hold of it. I said, oh God, let me have it. Let me see it. Let me know it. Let me feel it. Let me think it. Let me grow in it. Let me mature it. Let me fully realize it. Give to me the spirit of wisdom and revelation. What were those verses of scripture again? You went and you read back over them. You laid them before the Lord and said, God, I want to know this, not mentally. I don't want to just have a mental ascent. I just don't want to have a knowledge about it. I want to have an understanding and insight, a revelation of who you are and what you've done for me. Don't let it slip. Don't neglect this so great a salvation. Lay hold on it with both hands. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, I want you to find a bunch of people around you. Hug them, love them, tell them that you love them. Worship the Lord tonight with your offerings. Worship the Lord tonight with your tithe. Next week, Joe and Becky Cruz will be with us on Sunday. So I want you to come, be a part of the meeting, okay? And just be in expectation of great things in God. Hallelujah. Watch what Father's going to do. Praise the name of Jesus. Watch what God's going to do through you. Get a heavenly vision as you lay hold of who Jesus is and what He's done for you. Those of you watching us by web or by YouTube, all these things are yours in Christ Jesus. God has supplied them to whosoever will, anyone who calls upon His name. You can't continue to live a life conformed to this world and have all that God has promised. You've got to be willing to conform to the image of the Son. My goodness, He's given us everything that we need according to His life, according to His divine power. He's given us all of His life. He's given us all of His godliness. Don't miss out on Him. discover who you are in Him, and you won't want to be anything else. God bless you in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah.